Father, in the precious name of Jesus, we thank you. We give you praise. We give you glory. We thank you that your word is truth without error. And Father, we thank you for the hearer of your word. And the hearer will become a doer. And our lives will never, ever be the same. In Jesus' name, somebody shout amen. KK, let's get ready. All right, go with me in your Bibles to the book of Psalms 1. Psalms 1 is our foundational text. Let's raise our Bibles and give our confession of faith. Psalms 1. All right, let's raise our Bibles. Repeat after me. This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I can do what it says I can do. I am a believer, not a doubter. I am a doer, not just a hearer. And my life is the better after having heard the word of faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Somebody shout amen. God bless you. All right, Psalms 1 is our foundational text. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law do he meditate day and night. And he should be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. I've been talking to you about, you know, God the healer, and we've been dealing with this series, and we've been dealing with it for quite some time, and I'm going to continue to deal with it, because I know that in order for the believer to become resistant of certain elements that are trying to attack our body, faith must arise. So the Bible says that faith cometh by hearing, Romans 10:17, and hearing by the word of God. So we will continue to teach this as long as the Holy Spirit, you know, give me permission to, and then once he releases me from this, we'll move to something else. But right now we're dealing with God the healer, and boy, we have been through an intense study on this subject because, you know, the more revelation you have, the more difficult it is for the devil to, you know, draw you into, you know, this whole idea that whatever you're dealing with, you're at a disadvantage. No born-again believer is ever at a disadvantage when it comes to, you know, spiritual warfare, because God is with us, he's fighting alongside us, and he's working on our behalf. Somebody shout amen. So if you're going through anything, whether it's physical, spiritual, emotional, or psychological, you need to know that God the healer, he can heal you mind, body, and soul. All right, go to 3 John 2 and let's look at that real quick, because I want to show you that he can heal us mind, body, and soul. So 3 John 2 says, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prosper. We also read over in Psalms 1 where God wants to prosper us. Now, we don't want to ever, you know, be one dimensional when we hear that word prosper. Prospering in the kingdom is different from prospering in the world. In the world, we can prosper by where we live. You know, that would be somewhat of an indication that those people are prosperous. People point at where you live, what you drive, you know, Birkin bags and, you know, Gucci and Chanel, and all that could be somewhat of an indication that you are prosperous. But let's not forget that just like there's originals, there's fakes as well. So don't be moved by what you see with a lot of these people, because everything that's made, there's an original and there is an imitation. Come on, somebody shout amen. And so far in the kingdom, you have the same thing. You have people who are original, genuinely, they're living out the word of God, but you also have people who are faking this thing, you know, and we don't want to be, you know, governing our lives by the people that we're looking at who are prospering in one area, but they're not prospering, you know, in all areas. The Bible says we prosper. 3 John 2, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prosper. So God say, I want more than just your body to prosper. I want more than just you to have all the looks of prosperity. I want you to be prospering in your mind, your will, your imaginations, your emotions, and your intellect. I want you to be prosperous. prospers completely. Whole life prosperity is what we're after as believers. And that is why I'm preaching this message, because I want you to prosper in all areas. I don't want nothing missing or nothing broken. Come on now. You would never be perfect, but your life as a believer should be a whole lot better after Jesus than it was before Jesus. So we saw all throughout the scripture where we know it's the will of God for us to be healed. We saw where over in the books where they healed in the old. We saw over in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, those accounts from those disciples where Jesus went about doing good, healing all that was sick and oppressed, delivering all that was filled with demonic spirits. We saw all that. Then we see over in the book of Acts and the New Testament church where this healing anointing continued with the disciples of Paul and the disciples in those new dispensations. And so we're not going to argue with this whole idea or this whole principle that God is still healing today. Now, the problem with a lot of folks believing that is that when you don't have, you know, a relationship with God, that means you don't know him. You really don't know how he operates, and you really don't know how he functions. And we have been taught, you know, erroneously that healing is not for us today, that God cannot heal. And some people just die before their time because they've been taught, now, if you're sick, God must be trying to tell you something. Can I get somebody to wave at me, shout amen? If you're going through something, it's because something you did and God is punishing you for that. All of that's, you know, erroneous teaching. That is not the will of God. We know God does not hurt, harm, or disturb, you know, those in the covenant family. Now, in the law, we used to see, well, when you were disobedient, now, there were consequences, and those consequences have traveled from the law over into, come on somebody, the books, and those consequences are in this dispensation as well. You would not, you know, escape consequences for disobedience. So we've been talking to you about healing and talking to you about healthy eating and talk to you about a disciplined lifestyle, you know, just showing you throughout the word of God how we can combat these, you know, spiritual attacks from the enemy. And now we're up to the point we're dealing now with mental assaults from the devil. Go with me in your Bibles to the book of 2 Corinthians 10, verse number 3. We're dealing with mental assaults because I said that everybody is not dealing with, you know, physical sickness and physical diseases. There are some people who are dealing with emotional and psychological issues, and they're dealing with all types of, you know, issues, you know, that are affecting the way they think. And we always, and I have always made this statement very boldly, that if we whip the devil in our thinking, we can whip him in our life. It's not the will of God for you to be depressed. I mean, that's a spirit. God said he does not give us a spirit of fear, but love, power, and a sound mind. If you're constantly depressed, that means you need to work on your mental capacity, because the devil has infiltrated your thinking and he's drawing you into this state of recluseness. Because if he can get you into a depressed state, and if he can get you recluse from society and recluse from other born again believers, he then could start talking to you and begin to get you to compromise and even possibly hurt your own self. Because listen, the devil can't do anything to you but make suggestions. He can make a suggestion, but he can't kill you. Because if he could kill you, he would have killed you a long time ago. Come on, somebody shout amen. I'll prove that to you from the scripture, that the devil, he would suggest that you try to kill yourself, but he cannot kill you. Somebody shout amen. All right, so I said go to 2 Corinthians 10, verse number 3. We read this all the time. It's a very familiar passage of scripture. And so let me read this right here first before we go to 10 and 3. Go to 4, verse number 3. Go to 2 Corinthians 4, verse number 3. It says, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid from them that are lost. So the Bible says the gospel is hid from them that are lost. But let me go ahead and say this while I'm out here. You know, it matters. This matters right here, y'all. You know, we should have 2,000-3,000 people watching this. I see people doing all kinds of stuff on Facebook, man. I mean, they have 2,000-3,000 people watching, and they be watching stupid foolishness. This is what matters right here. And you know what? I'm so proud of those of you who click on and who come on every day and who watch. We may not have 2,000, we may not have 3,000, but what we and who we do have is enough for us to see, change in the life of the believer. I don't do this for, popularity. I do this because I love God's people and I want to see you have God's best. Come on, somebody shout amen. That's why I go through the word. I show you in the scripture. That's why I take time out to bring messages to you that I think will bring you some sense of hope and some sense of revelation. This is important, guys. What we're doing every day and what you're listening to every day, this is vitally important for your spiritual growth. The devil is trying to starve you spiritually, because if he know he can keep you spiritually malnutrition, he can keep you from being everything God wants you to be. So what the devil tried to do is he tried to weaken your resistance to sin and weaken your resistance to those things that are contrary to the word of God for your life. And the way he do so is he tried to cause you to have what I call a malnutrition spirit. So if we're getting into this every day and you're logging on every day, man, you're putting yourself in a position to have victory over life situations. Somebody shout, I have the victory. All right, watch what it says here in 2 Corinthians 4, verse number 3. Y'all come on back. Don't know what's going on. That's why we got to work on these systems, because there's always something that'll try to keep us from spreading the gospel. I mean, here we go. We start talking about something that's important. You know, the devil letting me stay on here all day and tell you, you're going to get a new car if you turn around 10 times and do the boogaloo. You know, he'll let you stay on here all day. If he say, if I tell you, if you prep 15 times and do 15 of them preps, that God will give you a financial windfall. But the moment you start talking about, renewing your mind and getting free in your mind, then that's when we have all these particular, glitches in the system. But thank God that we can come right back on and keep preaching. All right, now watch this, boy. But if the gospel be hid, it's hid from them that are lost, and whom the God, watch this, y'all, and whom the God of this world, watch this, who the God of this world had blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is in the image of God, should shine upon them. For we preach not to ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. So the Bible says that the gospel is hid to those who are lost. That is the devil that hides this gospel from those who are lost. And the reason why he hides the gospel is because the gospel is the good news. Somebody shout, the gospel is the good news. And he's working overtime to keep you from hearing this gospel, keep you from engaging in this gospel. All right, so go to 2 Corinthians 10, verse number 3. Y'all come on back. 2 Corinthians 10, verse number 3. All right, watch what it says here. You know this scripture. We read it all the time. It says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, through the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought. Come on, somebody. And making that thought obey God. And so now we know, see, that it's the gospel that the devil is after. You heard me say this all the time, and I'll say it again. The devil is not after you. He's after your faith. Because if he can get your faith, he can keep you from advancing. If he can keep you from engaging God from a spiritual place, he can keep you from experiencing the promises of God. So the gospel is hid to those that are lost. Lost how? They don't have, an intimate fellowship and relationship with God. So the enemy, he hides the gospel. He do everything he can to keep the born-again believer from engaging God from a spiritual place. And once again, that's why we sit and we hear the word and we preach the word, because we understand that it's the preaching and teaching of God's word that brings deliverance. So we've been talking about the whole makeup and how we should, as born-again believers, work on our mental capacity. Go with me in your Bibles to the book of 2 Corinthians 5:21. Go to 2 Corinthians 5:21, and I want to just show you throughout the word of God. I'm just going to go through some scripture. Here's what I'm about to do. I'm about to give you some medicine. Somebody shout, give me my medicine, Pastor. Because once we get the word and once we get in the word, healing starts to take place. Remember I said earlier this week, anything that you cover up, it cannot heal. I'm about to give you some word. I'm about to show you in God's word how to take medicine. I talked about one of my members who who had been on 25 pills. She was on 25 pills because she was having a mental challenge. Come on, somebody. And man, she could attest to this, that her life was up one day, down the next. I mean, she was walking in all types of, you know, anxiety and all types of fear. And boy, she was brought to the church by one of our precious members. I think it was Gwen. And I'm telling you, man, she sat under that word, and she sat under that word, and we kept feeding her medicine and giving her the gospel and loving on her. And boy, she went from 25 pills to 15 pills to 10 pills to 5 pills. Now she's on 3 pills. And the 3 pills that she on are not concerned, not pills that deal with her mental state. The Lord delivered her from that. Now she say, Pastor, I take a couple of high blood pressure pills, and that's all I'm on, Pastor. From 25 to 3, she was taking all of this medicine for her mental state. And when we start giving her the medicine of God's word, healing start taking place. That's why we take this word, because it's medicine. The Bible says when you hear the word, it's like medicine to the flesh. Come on now. It's healthy for you. So I'm about to give you your prescription for a renewed mind and for mental victory. Come on, somebody. I said, I'm about to give you your prescription. You have just pulled up. Come on now. You have just pulled up to the spiritual pharmacy. And I'm about to infuse you with prescriptions that are going to change how you see life and change how you see life situations. This is what the gospel is all about. The gospel is not about us wasting a bunch of energy with suggestions and wasting a bunch of time, you know, with our opinions. The gospel is raw, is real, is relevant, and this is what you need. Come on, somebody. So you can get your mind free. There's an old song that in Vogue used to sing, "Free your mind and the rest will follow." Y'all not hearing me tonight. And so let's give you your prescription. So go with me to the book of Galatians. I believe I said 2 Corinthians 5:21. Thank you, KK. 2 Corinthians 5:21. Because remember I said we have hoarders in the body of Christ. Remember earlier I talked about hoarders. You know, Vicky and I have a difference in what we like on television. I like hoarders. I don't like hoarders, but I watch hoarders because I learn so much from the dysfunction that a lot of these folks are faced with. I watch My 600 Pound Life, not so I can laugh at people who are overweight, but I'm trying to get a deeper understanding of what would make a person feel that so inadequate that they would do that to themselves. What would make a person, you know, live amongst all this filth and it becomes normal to them. They're hoarders, amen, and they leave their house and they go to work every day, and people have no idea that these people are sleeping on mounds of trash. People have no idea that these people are living, you know, in, I don't know what it's called, disgust. And these people are functioning in the earth. Well, we got church folks who are hoarding. They dress up on Sundays. Come on now. They worship like everybody else. I mean, they usher, they greet, they take care of the babies in the back, they sing in a choir, but they're hoarding all these emotions and they're hoarding all of these, you know, strongholds and these mental thoughts that are dragging them into the pit of despair. And I come to be, you know, what you need in this season of your life to help you rid yourself of things that are keeping you from experiencing God's best. 2 Corinthians 5:21, for he had made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be the righteousness of God in him. So God made me to be righteous. So it doesn't matter what has happened in my past. It does not matter what happened, you know, in my life. I am made to be righteous. All right, let's go look at some more scripture. Go to Galatians. I'm about to give you a bunch of medicine. Galatians 2 verse number 20. This is the kind of medicine that you need. When I was going through my chemo, I remember going to the hospital, and boy, one nurse came in and she started preaching to me. She started telling me, you know, that chemo was not going to affect my body. And she told me I need to talk to that chemo and I need to speak to that chemo. And I start taking the medicine of God's word. And I'm so glad that I had something in the cabinet. Come on, somebody shout amen. Have you ever had a headache and you went look for something in the cabinet and it wasn't there, and you thought, man, if I just had an aspirin, that'd help relieve some of this stress? Well, I had something in my house. Y'all not hearing me. Woo! Oh, glory to God. I say, I had something in my house. What's in your medicine cabinet? What's in your spiritual medicine cabinet? What kind of medicine do you have that when the enemy jumps up and tries to attack you, what are you going to pull out and what are you going to take in order to relieve yourself of that attack from the enemy? Then here's what it says over here. Come on now. At Romans 8, verse number 1. Somebody shout amen. Somebody shout amen. All right. Go back to Galatians. I've been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but the Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live after, you know, faith of God and who loved me and gave himself for me. So I've been crucified with Christ. No longer am I living out of my flesh, but I'm living in the Christ that dwells in me. All right. Go to Romans. Romans. We can see over in Romans 6. Romans, the 6th chapter, I believe. It says, we learn that our old self was crucified with Christ and buried with him, and we rise to a new life in Christ. We was crucified in Christ. We were buried with him. I mean, when he was crucified on the cross, and then when they buried him, we was buried with him as well. Somebody shout amen. When they buried Christ, when they crucified Christ, they buried him. And the Bible says that just like they buried him, we was buried as well. But just like he rose, we rose as well. Come on, somebody shout back at me. So I'm not who I used to be. When he was buried, come on. Hey, Sister Joanne Wade, good to see you. I got to stop and shout Sister Joanne Wade out. Sister Joanne Wade been on me practically all my life. Hey, Sister Wade, good to see you. So watch now, we were crucified with him and then we rose with him. So now I'm no longer who I used to be. But this take work, y'all. This take a whole lot of work to make the shift out of your mind that you're not who you used to be. And there are some people who the devil has attacked them in their mind, and they've got so comfortable with the way they live that they have no idea that they have mental issues. They have no idea that they have emotional issues. They need to really get in this word so the word can expose them to light, because they're living in darkness and nobody have challenged them to say, hey, you might need, you know, to be born again. There are some folks, y'all, who think they saved, that they really not saved. Here's why they think they saved. They think they saved because they go to church. Going to church does not make you saved, just like standing in a garage does not make you a car. Come on, somebody. Just because you go to church don't mean you saved. You got to, come on now, receive Jesus as your Lord, and then you got to let him disciple you. True discipleship is an indication of your lifestyle. How are you living? Because that's what's going to determine by other folks whether or not you saved for real. You can say all you want you saved. I mean, you can wear a big hat and you can do all that stuff. That is not an indication you saved. Your lifestyle is an indication that you're born again. How you deal with people, how you deal with life circumstances. And some people have these mental capacities, these mental dysfunctions. And the Bible says that God can even heal crazy folks. Y'all not hearing me. Oh, y'all not hearing me tonight. I say God can heal crazy people. I can show you in the scripture where there was a crazy man in the grave. And the Bible says that they had tied him up with chains, and they had tied him up with all of these, you know, ropes and things of that nature. And he would break free from them because this man was filled with legions of demons. Come on, somebody. He had a mental issue. He had so many demonic spirits in him that, you know, when one leave, another one come. Legions mean many of them. Jesus show up on the scene and he delivered this man from these legions of demons. This man had a mental issue. He was off in his thinking, and Jesus healed him of this mental, you know, in chemical imbalance, or what, you know, this mental retardation. God can heal that. He can. And some folks, they are dealing with these things because they have not yet allowed the blood of Jesus, as the Bible says, cleanse their consciousness of dead works. Let's take some more medicine. Go to Romans 8, verse number 1. All right. There, therefore, is no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. So there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Don't let folk try to condemn you, your past. You've been healed from your past. Come on, somebody shout amen. Let me give you some more medicine. Go to Romans 6, verse number 3 through 6. Romans 6. Somebody shout amen. Somebody shout hallelujah. All right. Romans 6, verse number 3. Know that you're, verse number 6. Now you know that so many of us were baptized unto Jesus Christ, were baptized unto death. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead, watch what it says now, to the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in the newness of life. So he said, now we were buried with Christ. We should be walking in the newness of Christ. Once you get into the Word of God, your life should be totally different than it was prior. That's why I say again, don't be, you know, a deterrent to people that are trying to find their way through life. We as believers, we should be examples of what righteousness and holiness look like. We're never perfect. And I almost hate to say that, because a lot of people like to use that as an excuse to misbehave. Well, you know, we're not perfect. Well, you 59 years old, you ought to be a whole lot better at 59 than you was at 9. Come on, somebody. How in the world could you still be acting the same way after being saved any length of time? I can tell you how. Because you don't have an intimate fellowship with God. Because there's no way that you could draw near to God and remain the same. Come on, somebody, preach back at me. I'm 25 years in the business. I've been saved for over 25 years. And I promise you, I am not doing something. I promise you, I'm not doing none of the stuff that I was doing. I may be eating like I was 25 years ago. But I'm not doing none of the stuff that I was doing 25 years ago. Man, I've been freed in my mind. My mind has been renewed. I mean, a whole lot of things have happened to me in 25 years that could have caused me to go back to where God delivered me from. But I was crucified with Christ. I died like he died, and I rose like he rose. But this time when I rose with a different way of thinking, a different way of believing, a different way of governing my life. You cannot tell me that you in Christ and you still acting like a child. Paul, read your own Bible. Paul said, when I was a child, I spake as a child. But when I became an adult, when I matured, he said, I put away childish things. So you cannot, you know, in good consciousness tell me, oh, I love me some God, but you not walking in love. You can't tell me that you are born again, blood washed believer, if you're not governing your life by principle. And it takes discipline to do so. It takes discipline to not be like you used to be. It takes you changing the environment that you used to hang in. If you continue to hang in the same environment after salvation, you're not going to walk in the newness of who God created you out to be. You got to change information that's fed into your spirit, man. Because when we hear the word, our flesh is not being fed. It's our spirit man that's growing. It's our spirit man that's developing. It's our spiritual man that's maturing. Our faith, it goes up, up, up the more we feed. Come on, I'm trying to help somebody. Just like the physical body. The physical body, it grows when you feed it. When I watch my 600-pound life, those people constantly feeding their self with food. Come on now. And they grow. And what the devil does, he deceive, and telling them that nothing is wrong. And they continue to grow. And they continue to get bigger. And they continue to get sicker. That's because they have renewed their mind. They think that, you know, if I can eat my pain away, come on now, I can drink my pain away, I can smoke my pain away, I can sleep my pain away, come on now, I can buy my pain away, I can try to impress my pain away. Some people work overtime trying to make folk to like them, and they go out their way trying to let people know that they are somebody. Man, you are somebody if you have nobody. I wish I had somebody. I say you are somebody if you had nobody. I'm not spending 1 ounce of energy trying to please nobody. I like me enough to, if I'm by myself, I'm glad about that. I don't need no whole bunch of nothing to make me feel good about myself. When you get a good self-image, when your mind is renewed and you know the price that was paid for you, you don't go out your way trying to get folks to like you. Because I guarantee you, the folk that you think like you, they are talking about you behind your back. All right, watch what the scripture said. I'm just going to show you from the Bible. All right, go to John 8, verse number 11. Oh, don't go to John. Go with me to 2 Corinthians 5:17. Hurry, y'all. I'm giving you some more medicine. I'm giving you medicine, feeding you more medicine. All right, 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. Go to 1 Peter 1. Go to 1 Peter 1. I'm just showing you from the word of God that you are not who you used to be. All right, 1 Peter 1, verse number 23. It says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. So he said, we're born again by the word of God. All right, go with me in your Bibles to the book of Luke 13, verse number 3. Luke 13, verse number 3. Somebody shout, I'm not who I used to be. I'm born again. Now, to be born again means to be born of the Spirit. Well, I think it was Nicodemus. He asked the question, Lord, how can a man be born a second time? Will he enter back into his mother's womb? And Jesus said, no, that which is born of the flesh is born of the flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is born of the Spirit. So we were all born of the flesh, and if we're going to, watch this, glory to God, if we're going to change how we function, we got to get born again. We got to get born of the Spirit, and you can go to church and not be born again. I hate to tell some of y'all this, you sitting in church, you hearing the preaching of the gospel, and you're not born again because you haven't confessed Jesus as Lord, and he has not just become Lord of your life, but he's Lord and Savior. Here's the problem, Paula. A lot of folk just want him to save them, but they don't want him to lord over them. Lord, save me, but I don't want to live right. Lord, save me, but I don't want to love right. Lord, save me. Come on, somebody, but I want to still act like I'm in the world. That's not what salvation is all about. I haven't been in a club in 23 and a half years. Somebody ought to say amen. I don't even know what kind of dances they doing right now. I'm all out of touch with the world because I've been out of the world, and I don't miss it. I don't miss anything that I was doing in the world. I don't miss no club. I don't miss no drinking. I don't miss no smoking. I don't miss no winking at girls. I don't miss no trying to get a hookup. I don't miss none of that. That stuff was a burden. That stuff was so, you know, had so much anxiety connected to it, because while you out there, you got to watch your back because somebody may try to run up on you and steal you while you're trying to date a girl, or somebody may scratch your car up. Somebody may, come on now, poke your tires and, you know, bust the windows. It's too much pressure to try to be out there in the world. Y'all not hearing me. You can't even go and get a drink without somebody trying to drop something in it. Back in the day when we was going to the club, I mean, come on, man. You know, you get your drink. I mean, one, because that's all you could afford. You know, even that back then they had 2-drink limit. But back then, you know, you get your one drink, or you sneak your bottle in, you bring your girl with you, you help put the burst bottle down at the bottom of her purse, and then she gonna pull you a little nip and come on, somebody. You know, man, I don't miss none of that stuff. I don't miss none of that. I'm so glad that I'm saved and I'm in the family of God. I'm so glad that I'm saved and my life is no longer governed by my flesh, but the life that I live in Christ. I've been crucified with Christ. Come on, somebody. Don't act like I'm the only one, Q. Watch this. Come on now. Go to Luke 13, verse number 3. I tell you, nay, but except you repent, you shall all likewise punished. So Jesus said, you got to repent. When you come into the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, you got to repent first. What does repent mean? To turn away from. If I'm going to renew my mind, if I'm going to live out the rest of my days with peace, joy, and happiness, I got to turn away from some things. All right, go with me in your Bibles to the book of John 8, verse number 11. John 8, verse number 11. I'm just giving you some medicine. This is the kind of medicine you need. John 8, verse number 11. No man, all right, verse number 11, she said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee, go and sin no more. Here's this woman that was caught in sin, and Jesus, come on now, he did not condemn her, he told her, go and sin no more. Go to Matthew 11, verse number 28, just giving you some medicine, feeding you the word of God. This is how spiritual growth takes place. Spiritual church spiritual growth does not take place by church attendance. You should go to church. When the church is back open, you ought to break the doors down to get in church. Especially if the Lord has kept you from contracting this coronavirus, you ought to break the door down trying to get back in the church house to give him praise. Because everybody we see God delivered, they went testified to it. The woman at the well who had a spirit of promiscuity. You know, promiscuity is a spirit. All these things affect your mind. If you just land, now y'all know I'm real, I'm radical, I'm relevant, I'm revolutionary. Watch this. If you just land up with everybody, how in the world could you just consciously just be laying up with all these different folks? I mean, golly, is something wrong with you mentally? If you go from one person to the next person, you sleeping with this one, you sleeping with that one. Come on now. You having all types of, you know, all types of lasciviousness and, you know, idolatry and adultery and fun. You just doing all of this stuff and it does not bother you. That means something is wrong in your mind. Something the devil have triggered, and there is a stronghold that's keeping you so bound that you think that is your way to find emotional and spiritual, you know, security. That if I can just get the right man. Now, this woman had more than one man. She had many men, and Jesus heals this woman of the spirit of promiscuity, which is a spirit. Sexual perversion is a spirit. You sitting up watching pornography all night. Not y'all. Somebody may come on here and see this later on. Sitting up watching pornography all night. That stuff get into your thinking. Now, for some of y'all who go to these churches that don't deal with real issues, sorry, but this is real. This is radical. This is Reynolds. This is real life. Folk are dealing with this kind of stuff, and really they don't want to be dealing with it, but they are addicted to it because that stronghold has got into their mental capacity and they're not able to walk free from it because they have allowed themselves to be infiltrated by the enemy, and their resistance to things that are erroneous have now become so low that they just fall for anything, and they really don't want to do it. They don't want to be doing all this, but they don't know how to break free. The only way you can break free is by the Son setting you free. Who the Son sets free is free indeed. And you don't get free now by going to church and listening to messages that has no redemptive value or no power. When Jesus preached, he preached under the anointing. Come on, somebody. There has to be an anointing present in order for freedom to take place. Can I say that one more time? There has to be an anointed present for true deliverance to take place. I'll say it one more time. In order for true deliverance to take place, you have to sit under the anointing. All right, go with me in your Bibles to the book of Acts 10, verse number 38. Let me prove that out to you from scripture. Acts 10, verse number 38. Somebody shout, it is the anointing. When you get this anointing, when this anointing show up, oh my God, all types of supernatural powers happen. All types of things happen when this anointing show up. That's why the devil don't want you coming to a church that like my that's gonna teach the word, come on somebody, under the anointing. He don't want you to be, you know, part of a ministry that's gonna challenge you to live right, challenge you to live holy, challenge you to live righteousness. He don't want that, so he'll keep the pastor silent on that. And a lot of times the pastor won't teach it because he himself ain't living it. I wish I had somebody. He in the boot in the back in the dog, so he's not gonna try to challenge you because, you know what, he feel like, hey, if I'm doing it, well maybe that's just what we all are all bound by. This. That's not the will of God. You need to be at a ministry that your man of God has come through something, has come out of something, and can testify to something. Those members of my church, you've been with me 20-some years, I haven't hid one thing. There's some stuff I'm going to have to take to the grave. Come on, somebody, because the Bible says that you confess your sins one to another, but they can't handle all your stuff. Some folk can't handle all the messes that God brought you out of. Some folk can't handle all the things God delivered you from. Some folks can't handle that. So you might need to just take that to the grave with you. But we should overcome and we should testify, because the Bible says, come on now, that we testify for the blood of the Lamb and the words of our testimony, that because of our testimony, God delivered me off addictions. My homeboy Petey would not be free right now. He had to see faith in action. He had to see somebody living this thing out. He had to see somebody walk it out. Come on, somebody shout, walk it out. You got to walk this thing out. It takes discipline. It takes a disciplined lifestyle to live by faith. It takes a lifestyle that's consumed with the word of God. You can never live the life that God has planned for you to live unless you live it by faith in his word. I say living by faith in his word, and not only living by faith, but also demonstrating what you hearing. The way that you break a habit is that for 90 days, you do something different than what you were doing before. If you want to break a food addiction, you eat different for 90 days. If you want to break a sexual addiction, you do something different for 90 days. You walk away from it. You be redeveloping, retrain your way of thinking. You begin to infuse yourself with the word of God so that the word can take over your mind, your will, your imaginations, your emotions, and your intellect, because that is where the true person lives. The true you is the way you think. If you can think the way that God said you should think, you can experience the things that God said you can experience. Remember, the Bible says, as a man thinketh, so is he. So you got to think the way God thinks. So the devil, he don't want you thinking on those things which are good, and those things which are lovely, and those things which are pure, and those things which have a good report. He don't want you thinking on these things. He wants you to think about all the bad times and how tough things were, and who molested you and who raped you. Come on, somebody. And I'm not diminishing none of that, and I'm very sensitive to all that. But if you let the word of God, which the Bible says it's the blood of Jesus which cleansed your consciousness of dead works, if you're going to be free, you got to free your mind, and the rest will follow. So he's after your mind, he's after your will. Because if I can get you healed in your will, your way of functioning, if I can get your will to line up with God's word, you will experience God's will for your life. If I can get your will to line up with God's word, you will experience the promises of God in your life. Y'all not hearing me? That is why you got to get your will, your mind. That's what the devil's after. Your will. If I can get your imagination healed, those things that are infiltrating your thinking, that's causing you to think, you know, different from the way you were created to think. If I can get your imagination, those things that you meditate on, if I can get that healed, come on, somebody. That's why God told Joshua to meditate on the word day and night. What was he trying to do? Brainwash Joshua. People used to say, man, y'all brainwashed over at that church. Yes, we were. We was washed the old thinking out, and we got new thinking in. You need to get brainwashed. You need to get in this word of God and let the word brainwash you. Wash that old way of thinking out, that old imagination out. Wash that old will out. Come on, your intellect. What you talk about intellect, Pastor? Lord wants your intellect to come up to a level where you could combat the enemy with the scripture. Remember, we're a tripart being, spirit beings, live inside of a physical body, and we possess a soul. The soul consists of mind, will, imaginations, emotions, and intellect. If I could get you intellectually sound to where you hear this word and you start allowing this word to dictate your emotions, which causes actions. Come on now, your intellect. If I can get your mind renewed, then your emotions will no longer be led of the spirit, and you will no longer misbehave, you know, and become, you know, who you used to be. But if your emotions are led by your intellect, and if your intellect is rooted in the word of God, when your intellect sends a signal to your emotions, it's going to send a signal that you ought to go right instead of going left. And then your actions will no longer be contrary and fleshy, but your actions will be reflective of the spirit realm. I'm preaching this thing out tonight for somebody. I'm trying to help you get free, because if you get free in your mind, you'll get free in every area of life. Stop letting the devil keep you bound by keeping you, you know, subjected to the flesh. You don't have to live by the flesh anymore. You've been crucified with Christ. You're no longer the person that you used to be. You're no longer, you know, the person that used to act certain ways and behave certain ways. You died to sin. You are now living a life of righteousness. Jesus died so you might become the righteousness of God. But the true work has to be done in your mind. If you change the way you think, if you change the way you believe, if you change your imaginations and your emotions and your intellect, your emotions, you can never govern your life by your emotions. I'm trying to help somebody. You would never have God's best being led by your flesh. I wish somebody shout amen. What is the flesh? I'm not talking about this physical, this your skin and bone. I'm talking about your mental capacity. If you are never, you know, if you're ever going to get free from living a life that drags you into the pit of despair, you can't live by your emotions the way you feel. You can't do what you feel. As a matter of fact, the reason why a lot of folk do what they feel is because they have no internal help. It's not until you get internal help will you be able to walk away from things that have kept you bound. What's internal help? Internal help comes from the Holy Ghost. When you get filled with the Holy Ghost, you have internal help now. Now you got another voice talking to you. The voice of carnality can no longer rule you. Now you got the voice of reasoning talking to you. Now you got the Holy Spirit telling you and prompting you and speaking to you. Come on, leading you and guiding you. All these churches that talk about you don't need to be filled with the Holy Spirit, they got a bunch of empty vessels sitting in there, because Jesus himself got filled with the Holy Ghost, and then he went over into the book of Acts and he left it to the disciples, and he expects for you to be filled. You can't live out your Christian life unless you get filled with the Holy Ghost, with the evidence of speaking in tongues. You can't be holy without the Holy Ghost. You can't stop cursing without the Holy Ghost. You can't stop smoking without the Holy Ghost. You can't stop lying without the Holy Ghost. You can't stop eating without the Holy Ghost. Your comforter, your helper, your teacher, and your guide. Boy, I have given you some medication for tonight. You ought to be shouting. You ought to be dancing. You ought to be getting your praise on, because we just opened up your spiritual medicine cabinet and loaded you up with stuff that's going to take you to the next things. Loaded you up with Luke. Loaded you up with Ephesians. Loaded you up with John. Loaded you up with Matthew. Loaded you up with Luke. Loaded you up with John. Loaded you up with the book of Acts, with the book of Ephesians. We just loaded up your medicine cabinet so that you can be healed in your mind. And when you take this medicine every day, just like my member who was on 25 pills are no longer on 25 pills, but she's in her right mind and she's giving God glory. That's the way you live the rest of your life, because when you got the right medicine in your cabinet, that medicine will produce everything that your heart's ever desired.